Welcome back, fantasy footballers. Today we are continuing in the little mini-series of mock drafts. We have mock draft round trace today, numeral 3. We've done round 1, which I'll link right here. And wait like 2 seconds for YouTube to let the next one roll in round 2. And I also have the blog post versions of them up on the website, which I'll link here. All of those will be down in the description as well. I suggest you watch or read the first two before we get into this one, because we covered the first 24 picks, 12 team, half point PPR mock draft up to this point for 2017 fantasy football. So today, round 3, we're going to cover picks 25 to 36. It's good math. It's a good start. I think we're on a roll right now. So without further ado, featuring Chance the Rapper, let's talk some fantasy. So starting off at number 25, a dude that a lot of people will be drafting way before pick 25 by the time the season rolls around, we have Gronk. The great Rob Gronkowski debate: is the injury risk worth the production, or is the production outweigh the injury risk? Now, that's the name of the game when you're taking a guy like Gronk, right? And I've never, maybe on one team in the last 4 years, have I owned Gronk. And that's simply because his asking price is the same every year. It's a first round pick, and I'm not okay taking a tight end in the first round. Owners who did last year paid for it. He'll be turning 28. Tight ends play forever, you know? They play till they're like 50. Give or take like 9 years. What concerns me obviously is the injury risk here. He had that ruptured disc last year. He had the surgery on his back. He had a surgery on his back in 09. He had a surgery on his back in 2013. I mean, how many shots can a dude take like that on his back? Octa said he needs a backyada. Like, you can bet going into this year that linebackers and safeties that don't want to fucking deal with Gronk on a regular basis are going to be aiming for that back. They're going to be coming hard and they're going to be shooting at that lower back. He said he's going to be ready to roll, no questions asked when the season rolls around. But we've heard that before, haven't we? When was it? Oh, last year, right. He must have misplaced his pads. He must have misplaced his helmets for the first couple games of last season before he started easing back into the lineup. So take what you hear from Gronk as hearsay. We know what happened last year, and we know a lot of guys got burned because of that. But looking at last year's production, Gronk being Gronk, he was an absolute fucking animal, like usual. He only wound up with 25 catches, but those 25 catches, he put up 21.5 yards per catch, which is absurd. When you look at him on a per-game basis in terms of fantasy points, he was tight end number one, easily. And a lot of that factors into the games that he was eased in, the games that he wasn't used very much. So when you take those out, and when he was at full health, full Gronk health, he's tight end number one on a points per game basis, and it's not even close to anyone else in the class. I guess my takeaway here is, right now I have him at pick 25. I think by the time the season rolls around, he'll creep his way into, he's not going to get into the first round in any drafts, I don't think, because of the injury history, but I think he'll find his way in to probably the 12 to 18 range. And if I'm in the latter half of that, say you're in a 12-team league and you pick in the 3 hole or something, you can get Gronk at 18 to 20, I'm probably okay with that, as long as all the reports say that he's good going forward. All right, next up, number 26, a guy that I absolutely love going into 2017, and I feel like he's going to end up on a lot of my teams, especially if he's going to be going in this range, and that's Doug Baldwin from the Seattle Seahawks. And he's probably one of the most underrated wide receivers in the entire NFL right now. And I think people shy away from him, especially in fantasy, because, one, he's undersized. He's like 5'10", 200, not even 200 pounds. Soaking wet, 200 pounds, right? And, you know, a lot of people will say, like, hey, you know, we have guys like Antonio Brown, Odell Beckham, who are that size. Like, why is Doug Baldwin being centered out for this when they're not? And it's because he also lacks the flashiness and, you know, all the charades that those two put on between Odell and Antonio Brown. They're off the field, they're dancing, all that bullshit. Doug Baldwin doesn't do that. Therefore, not only is he not being like seen as a character, but he's undersized, so a lot of people just kind of see him as, you know, a wide receiver who's putting up respectable numbers. But the dude gets the fucking job done. The Seahawks offense has been a top 12 scoring offense in the NFL for 3 consecutive years, and when you look at his individual numbers, the numbers don't lie. In each of the past 5 years, Baldwin's number of targets has increased linearly. And looking at Russell Wilson and an offense and a quarterback as a whole, each of the 5 years, in those 5 years, Russell Wilson's pass attempts, completions, and passing yards have all increased. So you can see they're slowly moving towards being a passing offense. Pete Carroll's smart. He knows this. He understands he doesn't have that elite back right now like he had with Marshawn, and the offense is adapting to it. And props to them for that. Now, Baldwin's put together back-to-back top 10 fantasy seasons as a wide receiver, and he's not getting the attention and the respect that he deserves for doing so. You know, people called it a fluke in 2015 when he put up those huge scoring numbers. I think he had 14 touchdowns, right? And you're like, oh, there's no way that's attainable for the next year. And you're correct. He didn't. He dropped from 14 to, I think, 7. But doing so, he had 16 more catches. He had more receiving yards in 2016. So I know that the touchdown numbers obviously had to regress, but he improved on in other areas of his game. Now, going into 2017, another reason I love him is he's easily the number one target on the outside there again. It's not like they added a new guy through free agency. I don't think they're going to use one of their first-round picks on a wide receiver. They don't even know who the number two is going into 2017. They have Tyler Lockett, obviously, on the outside, but he's not going to be a 120 target kind of guy. He's a slot guy. He's a weapon. You know, he's not a legit outside wide receiver that some people thought he might be. He's explosive, obviously, but he's not going to take targets away from Baldwin. And probably the last thing I would say is a positive for Baldwin going into 2015. When you look back at last year, I mean 2017, when you look back at 2016, Wilson couldn't scramble at all. Obviously, he was hurt. He was playing with injuries throughout the year. So there were like 5-6 games in a row where he could barely move outside of the pocket, which puts a damper on the offense as a whole because that's such a big part of that offense. And it gives time for Baldwin and it gives time for those receivers to get open. And a lot of the big plays from 2015 that Baldwin had were on scrambles from Wilson going out and chucking him the deep ball. So I think that opens up even more of the offense for him. So as the number one target in an offense that's moving to a passing offense, a guy that's proven it time in and time out now for a few years back-to-back, I just love what Baldwin brings in terms of his floor and in terms of his ceiling as a top 10 fantasy wide receiver. So I love me some Baldwin at 26. I almost hate myself for doing this because he brought me so much pain last year in so many of my leagues. I honestly might let him go undrafted this year. And if you follow me last year, you probably already know what I'm talking about. All right, we're talking about fucking Allen Robinson of the Jacksonville Jaguars. Worst team in the NFL. Not really, but this is a guy I've had trouble kind of deciding my opinion on going into 2017, because you look at the offense and they've had no changes. Like, what changes do they have going from 2016 to 2017 that would bring back Allen Robinson's elite level of fantasy play, right? So last year, on nearly the exact same target total that he had in 2015, in 2016, his receiving yards dropped from 1,400 to 883. His touchdowns went from 14 to 6. And instead of being wide receiver 4 in fantasy, he finished as wide receiver 31 when he was being drafted between 4 and 8 in that range. So I think the big question here is, you know, who do you blame for this? Do you blame A-Rob? Do you blame Blake Bortles? Is it a combination? Is it TJ Yeldon's fault? I think it's definitely a combination. When you look at the number of drops Allen Robinson had, he was dropping a lot of easy balls, a lot of balls that he should have had. He had 9 drops, which was tied for 4th in the NFL. But there was a lot of high-profile, high fantasy player names on the drop list. And drops are not necessarily a parallel to the success you have in fantasy, so I'm not really going to like knock it in that terms, but he had a lot of big drops that he could have, you know, went for scores. He had a few balls off the fingertips that I think could have boosted his stats. Overall, a terrible year for him, though. And then when you look at Blake Bortles, he came out and said he was playing with 2 separated shoulders, wrist tendonitis, whatever he had. He certainly played like he had those injuries. So this offseason, Blake Bortles is working with an expert to fix his mechanics. That's great, right? Well, the problem with that is he's going to be in his 4th year in the NFL. You don't start fixing your mechanics 4 years into the NFL, right? You fix your mechanics in college. You fix your mechanics in the summer leading up to college and in up to the draft. You fix your mechanics after your rookie season, not 4 years into your NFL career, right? Now, I tried to find some numbers. I was digging through numbers to get some kind of accuracy reading on Blake Bortles and like how accurate his throws were and stuff, but I couldn't find anything on the internet. Yeah, I'm sure later in the summer I'll be able to find some articles on him, but couldn't find anything besides a completion percentage, which is a skewed number to begin with because throws are everywhere. I guess the one positive you can take away is how the season ended when Gus Bradley officially took over as the offensive mind behind the offense. A-Rob and Bortles both had their best games of the season, and I'm definitely not going crazy on a sample size that small, but it's good to see nonetheless. If, you know, maybe it was a change of scenery they needed, something internally to kind of get the mojo back going for them too. You know, a healthy Bortles will obviously play a role in 2017. A-Rob maybe being more focused after having a terrible year. He's an elite athlete, so I'm hoping his mindset can get right. He can work hard and really gain that chemistry with Blake Bortles. My intuition says that A-Rob falls somewhere in between last year and 2015. So I think 1,000 yards is definitely possible for Allen Robinson. I think the other thing to take away is when you look at his targets down by the end zone, he was tied for 6th in the NFL in targets inside the 10-yard line, which is a really high number, and it's really good because the Jaguars don't get there that often. So for him to have that high volume of targets down there tells you that he's a huge part of that game plan still, because who know, they have no running game, which is a positive when they're at the goal line, and who knows whether they're going to be able to get there in 2017, because they're not going to be a good offense, obviously. So it's good to see those numbers. So get those targets. So I think he lands probably somewhere around 1,000 yards, 7 to 8 touchdowns. So a decent low-end wide receiver too, probably. A lot of question marks surrounding the situation. So moving on to pick number 28, we actually have a surplus of wide receivers about to spring off the board here. Over to the West Coast, so we're moving to the Raiders. The Raiders. Oh, woo! Amari Cooper, the Raiders. Now, I know this is going to be a fun debate all offseason. Amari Cooper, Michael Crabtree. And why would you take Cooper at pick 27 when you can get Crabtree at pick 85? Well, that was last season. You're not going to get Crabtree there anymore. People are smartening up to the whole debate between those two. And Crabtree will probably be going somewhere between picks like 40 and 50 this year. But where they finished last year, it was, let me say, Cooper finishes wide receiver 15 in PPR. Crabtree is wide receiver 12. So Crabtree, a little difference there. And then Cooper is 13 and Crabtree is 14 in standard. Or flip that, actually. Crabtree first. But straight up, in terms of value, obviously Crabtree is a nice play here where you would get him. But Cooper is the guy that you want in that offense. I know the numbers don't say so from last year, but you got to look at the game film. You got to look at what actually happened there in Oakland. So Crabtree had 15 more targets last year than Cooper did. He also had 3 more touchdowns. But Cooper actually racked up 150 more receiving yards than Crabtree did. And that tells you that they play two completely different styles of football, right? Cooper had almost identical target numbers 2015, 2016, but he was able to add 10 more catches and 80 more receiving yards to his total. Crabtree is that over the middle possession kind of guy, and Cooper is the explosive, the deep threat, makes those big plays, and but he's much more than that. He's a very good all-around receiver as well. Good route running skills, good agility, things like that. What killed me was watching Cooper last year. He had like, I feel like I saw him like 5 separate times, was just like a fingertip away from a 60-yard touchdown. And I think a couple more of those connect, and you're looking at Cooper in an entirely different point of view, entirely different league than Crabtree is. I feel like that's closer to the actual numbers that Cooper will be putting up once those deep balls connect. So what's interesting is when I started looking at the red zone numbers. Now I'm gonna read this because I have a lot of like writing and numbers on notes here. Inside the red zone, Crabtree out-targeted Cooper 21-13. So he's getting more looks in the red zone, but when you get inside the 10, the gap narrows to 8-7 in favor of Crabtree. So it's very close inside the 10. I forget which fantasy expert just finished an article. It's called Actual Opportunity Article, I think. I'll link it down below. Awesome, awesome, awesome series of articles. And basically he did a study and it looks at once you get outside of the 10-yard line, all targets are basically even in terms of expected fantasy points. So that those red zone numbers don't really matter that much once you get outside like a 12-yard line. What matters is those targets inside the 10-yard line, and the fact that Cooper and Crabtree kind of line up evenly in terms of targets there is a good teller of expected fantasy points and what the ceiling actually is for both of them. Crabtree was the only player in the NFL with at least 5 targets inside the 10-yard line without a single reception. Well, it's not a good thing. There's obviously room to grow there because, you know, if he's going to get 8 looks inside the 10-yard line, next year he might convert 2 or 3 of those into touchdowns, right? There's definitely ceiling there. Now that Latavius Murray is out of the equation, he's no longer the goal line back and he scored so many touchdowns last year, you got to think that, you know, they're going to be looking to air the ball out, especially with Carr going to be back healthy. And one more thing, you could see that Cooper dramatically improved on his game from 2015 to 2016. In 2015, Cooper led the NFL in drops with 18. That's an outrageous number. I didn't look back, but I can imagine that's like possibly top five worst drop totals in the history of the NFL. He improved it from 18, and last year he only had 4 drops. So, you know, maybe it was the rookie jitters, he was nervous, whatever it was, he tremendously improved. And I think he got that problem out of the way. I just think there's a ton of upside with Cooper here. I just think that with all those things coming together, Cooper catches a couple more of those deep balls, maybe catches a couple more of those looks inside the 10. He's just developing into a really nice receiver, and this is going to be his third year. So he's due for a breakout because his talent level is just so high. You know what? Looking back on it now, I'll probably take Cooper over Allen Robinson. So I'm an idiot, and I write these things like I wrote this like 2 weeks ago, and now while I'm saying shit, I'm like, you sound stupid for saying all that shit and then putting him behind Allen Robinson. Either way, you know, comment down below. Who would you rather have this year, Amari Cooper or Allen Robinson? Straight up. If you can take one guy, no draft value involved, just straight up one guy on your team, half point PPR, who do you want? A-Rob or Amari Cooper? Comment down below. All right, so we're moving on to picks number 28 and 29, I believe. I'm going to be super lazy here. And 28 is going to be Brandon Cooks. 29 is going to be Terrell Pryor. But I already touched on those guys in pretty great depth in my free agency wide receiver video. So rather than me talking about them each for another 5 minutes, just go watch the video here, and they're both talked about in pretty good depth. Go check that one out. Or you can read the blog article again on my website, bdgeat.com. It's there in the blog section. So Brandon Cooks, 28, Terrell Pryor, 29. Move on to number 30. I think I'm counting right. I could be wrong, but this one's going to come as a nice little shock for a couple of you. Shock for myself, and I was writing down the names and deciding who I wanted to pick here. But I'm going to go against what I've always done. I always wait on quarterbacks, but I just, there's nothing to not love about Tom Brady here. Pick 30. He should be the first quarterback off every board in 2017 drafts. But the weapons around him are just insane this year. I think Brady's fantasy potential and ceiling is all time. They sign Brandon Cooks. They sign Dwayne Allen to replace Bennett. They sign Rex Burkhead, another good pass catcher out of the backfield. Everywhere you look in New England, it's just playmakers everywhere. You remember how many times last year Brandon Cooks turned a Drew Brees dump-off pass into an 80-yard touchdown? Just add those stats onto Brady's stats of last year. Like, that's going to happen multiple times. He didn't have a player like that in 2016, even though he dominated the league. Oh, man. I mean, we have to see what the whole LeGarrette Blount situation is, but, you know, if LeGarrette Blount, this is kind of a reach, but if LeGarrette Blount is not back in New England, that could mean more QB sneaks for Brady on the one-yard line, because Blount obviously had a million scores from the one-yard line, and Brady's been very successful in his career doing those sneaks, so maybe that could be more rushing touchdowns for him, more upside. You know, the rushing attack is going to be taken down a bit if he's not there, and even if it's not sneaks for Brady, it's going to be more passes in that area. Passing the ball, he hasn't lost a thing. He threw for at least 3 touchdowns, if not more, in 7 of the 12 games he played in last year. Like a ridiculous 28-2 touchdown interception ratio. He doesn't have the Deflategate bullshit to deal with all offseason. That's not going to be on his mind. All he wants is that next ring. That's all he wants. It's all he's going to be focused on. I think Brady comes into this year just on absolute fire. 350 yards a game, 3 touchdowns a game. Just locked up quarterback one for me, no doubt in my mind. Now's where things start to get a little interesting. The players have a few more question marks than the players that have gone already. 31, 32, 33, 34, 35. Okay, so we're on. Brady was 31. So Keenan Allen, 32. We know the storyline here. He was on pace for a gajillion targets. He's on pace for a gajillion receptions. About 14 minutes into the 2016 season, Keenan Allen unfortunately left with a torn ACL. I feel like the phrase, well, if you average his numbers out to a full season, is just going to be like the slogan of this guy's career. Like, there's only so long you can hang on to an 8-week period of a player's career that happened 3 years ago, right? Like, how long are you going to hold on to that, those numbers for, before you start taking it into account in his ADP? You know, that being said, I mean, he's, even with all this missed time, he's clearly still going to be the number one possession receiver in that offense. They have Terrell Williams on the outside, who's probably going to be very underrated this year, but a nice outside deep threat for the Chargers. Either way, Keenan Allen's going to be a PPR monster again, as long as he can stay healthy. I'm definitely factoring his injury risk far into my ADP, which is why I'm going at pick 32, as opposed to like last year when he was going in the middle of the second round, I believe. It was like probably from pick like 12 to 18, somewhere in that range. But I'm going to take a slight step back on him just because the injuries, the touchdown upside is always limited. But in PPR leagues, he's obviously a very good play and he's a good game. You guys know the deal with Keenan Allen. So next up we have pick number 32. And it's going to the Broncos, Denver, and that's going to be C.J. Anderson. This is a guy I've been debating a lot with myself, and I think by the time the season rolls around, I'm going to be way higher on him, and I feel like I might own him on a lot of my teams as possibly my RB1 if I want to go wide receiver heavy in the beginning, if I don't get one of those top picks. He played about seven games. He didn't play about seven games. He played in seven games last year before going on the IR for the torn meniscus. But he was the guy in that backfield for the seven games, right? He was averaging 18 touches a game, and he scored five times in those games, which is a great, you know, efficiency number from that point of view. An interesting stat I read from, I'm going to just read this off straight off from an article I read in Pro Football Focus yesterday. So I'm just going to read this straight off. Credit to Pro Football Focus. I'm not sure the name of the article or the author, but this is them. Anderson ranked top five in carries inside the 5 yard line per game and top five in red zone opportunities per game. His backup, Devonta Booker, was highly inefficient throughout the entirety of the season, posting 0.5 less yards per carry than Anderson. Over the past three seasons, among 28 running backs with at least 400 attempts, Anderson ranks top six in yards per carry, touchdowns per carry, yards after contact per attempt, and forced missed tackles per attempt. So for perspective, Le'Veon Bell ranks top six in three such categories and is the only other running back to rank top six in more than two. What does that say? He's stupidly efficient when he's on the field. Now, when he went down, I feel like low-key a lot of people, fantasy owners, and NFL guys, like, not that they were happy he went down or nothing like that, but they wanted to see what Devonta Booker brought to the table. And, you know, it was his time to play the feature role back there. And a lot of people came into the season like, oh, Devonta Booker is eventually going to take that role. He's going to be that guy. Oh, he came in and he sucked shit. He was averaging 3.5 yards per carry, which dipped to 3.2 yards a carry in games where he got double-digit touches or double-digit carries. And by the end of the season, he was getting taken over by Justin Forsett. It's clear that Booker's not the answer there. The question is CJ? And obviously the question is, will he be on the field, right? Now, when you look at the Broncos as a whole, the quarterback situation is not good. Their offense as a whole wasn't good last year, right? They spruced up their line a little bit. They took Ronald Leary from the Cowboys, which is obviously a good upgrade there. And they replaced Russell Okung with Menelik Watson. Shout out Marist College. Fox is up. Was good. So the line is definitely looking a little bit better than it was last year. So, you know, it's either going to be Simeon or Paxton Lynch under center next year. I wouldn't be surprised to see a combination of both. It's what we saw last year. And, you know, Anderson's going to have his work cut out for him. I think when you get to this late in the draft, any of the running backs are going to have question marks. And given Anderson's upside and his talent and the production that you've seen on a per-game basis, I think he's a good, not a safe pick, obviously. He's high risk, but I think he's definitely worth gambling on at this point in the draft because he could be that feature back in an offense that runs the ball a lot. So moving on to pick number 34, Jarvis Landry of the Miami Dolphins. He came out yesterday and said that they're no longer, Miami Dolphins are no longer the little brother to the Patriots. Here's to you, Jarvis Landry. I don't know what you were drinking, but it probably wasn't coffee. It was probably lean or some shit in this cup. I don't know what you did in 2016 that you made you feel that way, but you're an idiot. And I think at this point we know exactly who Jarvis Landry is in terms of a player, in terms of a fantasy player. He's going to give you a ton of targets. He's going to give you a ton of receptions. He's going to give you a ton of receiving yards. And that's about it. What he's not going to give you is touchdowns. He scored five his rookie year, four, then four again. So that's like, that's him. That's him as a player. And every year there are articles that come out like, oh, he's due this year. This is the reason he didn't score, blah, 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 blah. The numbers aren't lying here. That's just what he does. He's not involved in the red zone. He only had nine targets inside the red zone, which tied him with guys like Tyler Boyd and Tavon Austin. He only had two targets inside the 5 yard line, and their offense is going to be almost identical to what it was in 2016. You know, they have Devontae Parker coming back, they re-signed Kenny Stills, and I would think that the only thing that would change on the offense is maybe giving Jay Ajayi the ball a little more, giving him more carries, so that's definitely not a positive for Landry. I think he's he's a great PPR pick. Obviously, he's a very, very safe pick in PPR to give you 5 to 7 receptions every single week. So he was wide receiver 13 in PPR leagues last year, wide receiver 17 in standard. You need to draft accordingly to that kind of skew. 5. Now, this is an interesting one, too. Out of KC, out of the Chiefs. Andy Reid and the Chiefs. We got Spencer Ware, the running back. You know, this might change a little bit. I mean, all these, obviously, I'm doing these early, but Spencer Ware was the guy for Kansas City last year, right? They didn't sign anyone out of free agency. They let go of Jamaal Charles. And, you know, we have to see if they do anything through the draft. I would highly doubt that they're going to pick a running back as one of their top picks. But, you know, Ware was the clear workhorse in an Andy Reid offense, which is continuously over and over and over and over again been a huge fantasy factor. Anyone in that position does work. You know, he finished the season as RB16. He had 1,370 total yards, 5 total touchdowns, which is somewhere that he definitely needs to improve upon. But he was a clear workhorse. Again, he averaged almost 18 touches a game, which are definitely, you know, RB1 type of numbers. And you're going to be able to get him later in the draft. But the problem with Ware, apart from just having 5 touchdowns, obviously, is, you know, it was fatigue. Towards the end of the season, his performance dipped pretty dramatically. From weeks 1 to 7, Ware played in 6 games. And in those 6 games, he averaged 130 total yards a game. And then from week 8 until the end of the season, he played in 8 games. And in those 8 games, he only averaged 82 yards a game. And which is not bad, though, because you know that's something that he knows he's going to have to work on. He's going to have to be healthy throughout the season. He's going to have to keep his body in shape. And that was his first year as a fullback. And Andy Reid said, let me quote him, "I'm a big Spencer Ware fan." Reid said, "I like him. The kid's dirty tough. He's going to give you an honest down every snap. He's not real fancy. That's not his deal. But he can block, he can catch, and he can run. So there's a place for Spencer Ware." So you can take that one of two ways. He said he can block, he can catch, he can run, and he likes the kid a lot. So there's definitely a place for him in that offense. You know, whether that's going to be a full-time or whether he sees it as a mix, it's, you know, it's hard to tell. But normally Andy Reid likes to have one back that he kind of feeds the ball a lot to. Without Jamaal Charles, I like Ware to get the large majority of touches there. We're going to have to see what they do through the draft. But if they don't draft anyone, Ware's value can shoot up pretty dramatically before draft time. And then lastly, we have pick number 36, another guy that I covered in the wide receiver free agency vid, Alshon Jeffrey of the Philadelphia Eagles. And he's probably the guy that I like least out of all the big name wide receivers that moved this free agency. And I love his ability, obviously, as a player, his talent, his upside, all that good shit. But I don't really love the situation that he's in now in that offense with Carson Wentz leading the way. I'm not a believer in Carson Wentz as a quarterback, as a thrower. And I feel like they have a ton of weapons there already between Jeffrey, Torrey Smith as a deep guy, Jordan Matthews and Zach Ertz over the middle for touchdowns and things like that. And then Darren Sproles obviously coming out of the backfield. So there's a lot of mouths to feed in that offense. Carson Wentz is a young guy, right? He's a young quarterback, second year. It's going to take time to just develop chemistry between him and Alshon Jeffrey if they're not already, you know, getting to work now. It's not something that comes so quickly. Maybe 1,000 yards, maybe 6 to 8 touchdowns again. The Allen Robinson, Alshon Jeffrey debate and anyone in between is a decent debate looking into going into next year, but I'm lowest on Jeffrey because I think his ceiling is kind of lower. So there you have it. Round 3, picks 25 through 36 of the Mock Draft 2017 fantasy football season. If you miss one or two, go check them out down below. If you like the video, please make sure to give it a thumbs up because that's how people find the channel. I can't wait for it to get really into the offseason where people are really watching and engaging and shit. So, you know, comment down below if you disagree with any of my picks or you have any other cool stats or something to add into it. But besides that, you can go follow my fantasy football Twitter account. It's BDGEAT Fantasy. And go check out the website with the blog. I'll be updating blog posts throughout the offseason. Hope y'all enjoy. Peace. Right stroke, put a baby in the spiral. Soprano C, we like to keep it on the high note. It's levels to it, you and I know. Bitch, be humble. Hold up, bitch. Sit down. Hold up, be humble. Bitch. Sit down. Be humble. Bitch, sit down. Be humble.